Hello everyone. Today we will discuss about principle of thin layer chromatography and how TLC is used in order to analyze a mixture of different compounds. So in this lecture we will talk principle of thin layer chromatography, calculation of RF values of different spots on a TLC plate, troubleshooting in TLC, and at last, we'll discuss about separation of leaf pigments using paper chromatography. The principle of paper chromatography and TLC is same. So, invention of chromatography was done by Michael Swett, a botanist who was working on plant pigments. So, Swett basically extracted plant pigments and then loaded on top of a column which was packed with calcium carbonate, and then he poured ether on the top of the column so ether could take this mixture of leaf pigment across calcium carbonate. So calcium carbonate work as a stationary phase here, and when ether took these pigments across calcium carbonate, the separation of pigments could occur. For example, here we could see that this green color pigment, the red color, and then another one. So three different spots were observed when the pigments were separated on a calcium carbonate column. So in this we can see that the spot, if you call them A, B, and C, the C band is moving faster in comparison to A band on calcium carbonate column. That simply means the A has more interactions with the calcium carbonate, which is stationary phase here. So the principle of chromatography we have discussed in one of the earlier lecture, and that is essentially same for all type of chromatography techniques. So here in a chromatography system, the separation of analytes occurs on the basis of differential interactions of the analyte with the stationary phase. So in this situation, A compound that make a stronger interaction with calcium carbonate. So that simply also means that A has more similar nature as calcium carbonate, whereas C compound is moving faster. So stationary phase is taking C compound faster. That means C has similar nature with the mobile phase, which is ether, and it makes lesser interaction with the stationary phase, which is calcium carbonate. So that is the basic principle of any chromatography technique. So in a silica gel thin layer chromatography technique, first we make a glass plate. And on this glass plate, a silica gel or any other matrix, any other stationary phase, whatever is desired, that is overlaid. A thin layer of silica gel, for example, is loaded on this TLC plate, a glass plate. And now using a pencil, the one end, 1 to 2 centimeter from one end is marked. So basically, this is done in order to spot where sample to be loaded on a TLC plate. So on the middle of this mark, which is made by a pencil, sample is loaded. So sample on TLC is loaded, which is in liquid state, and in fact, a fine capillary is used to load sample here on the middle of this line, which has been drawn from 1 to 2 centimeter from one end of this plate. Now it is dried, the sample is dried, and after the silica plate and sample both are dried, these are put in a jar which contain mobile phase. So this is a jar, a beaker, which contain a mobile phase, what you call a solvent here. And it should be ensured that where you have loaded sample, that should not touch this solvent. Otherwise, it will be solubilized in the sample and it will go off the silica gel plate. Now, what will happen? This mobile phase will start moving up through capillary action, because silica gel is porous in nature. So, through capillary action, this solvent, which is also we call mobile phase, it will move upwards. So, in that situation, This mobile phase will dissolve sample and will take sample also along with it across the silica gel plate. And when this solvent, which is also mobile phase, it reaches up to 1 to 2 cm from the top. For example, here. So this also 1 to 2 cm. So this is this silica gel plate is taken off and it is dried. And then we develop the spot, because if the spot, if the analytes are colored, you can visualize them with your own naked eye. But if they are not colored, in that case development is required. Development means a chemical should be sprayed on the silica gel plate in order to view, in order to visualize these spots. So for example, here we have got two spots, spots A and spots B. So in this condition, spot B has traveled faster in comparison to spot A from bottom of the silica gel plate. That simply means the B has a similar nature as the mobile phase, whereas A has more similar nature with the stationary phase, which is silica gel here. So in fact, this migration of spots is measured in term of retardation factor, which is called RF value. So RF value of any a component, for example for A, is equal to the distance traveled by the solvent, which is distance from origin to where the mobile phase, the final mobile phase has run the solvent front. So this distance is ds, and distance traveled by A is this one dA from origin. So RF value of A spot is equal to dA upon ds. So distance traveled by analyte divided by distance traveled by the mobile phase is equal to RF value of that analyte. Similarly, for compound B, the distance traveled by compound B from origin is dB, and RF value for B is equal to dB divided by ds. So these distances are measured using a scale from origin, where the first line was drawn using a pencil, and then up to center of the spot. So this RF value is basically defined as the distance the center of the spot moved divided by the distance the solvent front moved. And they both are measured from the bottom, which is origin. So in this condition, we can say that component B, which is moved faster, it has more RF value, whereas compound A, RF value is less. So that is also in turn because of chemical nature of both the compounds A and B. Compound A is more polar, so this is holded, it is withheld by the stationary phase, which is also polar in nature, silica gel here. And component B is not being withheld well by the stationary phase, so it moves faster. So that's why we can say that component A is polar, whereas component B is less polar in nature. Now, compounds also can be identified using TLC. So RF value can be used to aid in identification of substance by comparison to standards. So when identification to be made, in that condition a broader silica gel plate is used, where along with your sample, for example, sample is loaded at A spot, and B, C, D, the standards can be run in order to compare their migration with the sample. So in the RF value is not a physical constant. So that's why the comparison should be made only between spots on the same sheet. So standard and the sample should be run on the same silica gel plate, because this is not a constant value, so it is relative. So in this condition, we can compare the RF value of standard with our sample, and in that way a sample can be identified. For example, the two substances that have the same RF value, for example here this one and with the standard this one on the C, so we can say that in the sample this component is actually C. And similarly, we can see the RF value of here is matching with the B, with the same RF value. So this component is actually B, and this last one is matching with the D. They have the same RF values if you measure the distances. So that's how compounds can be identified. So two substances that have same RF value, those may be identical, and those with different RF values are not identical. So that's how compounds can be also can be identified using RF values on a TLC plate. Now the resolution. The separation between two analytes on a chromatogram can be expressed as the resolution RS, and resolution RS can be defined by distance between center of the spots, the two spots where resolution need to be calculated. So distance between center, which is here shown as capital D, so that can be taken up, can be measured, and that can be divided by average diameter of both the spots. So when the distance between center of two spots is divided by average diameter of the both the spots, it gives a number which is called RS or resolution. Generally in TLC, if the RS value is greater than 1, the analytes are considered to be resolved. And for example here, these two spots are well resolved. They can be seen with the naked eye, whereas here there is an overlapping between both the spots, so resolution is weak here. So in order to improve resolution, concentration of analyte can be increased. For example here they are too close, two spots are too close, so if their concentration is reduced, they will be resolved, they will be separated from one another. So resolution can be improved by reducing concentration of the analyte, and also by changing polarity of the mobile phase. If polarity of mobile phase changes, it means their differential interactions with the mobile phase and stationary phase also will be altered. So that is another way to improve resolution. And the length of the plate also can be increased in order to enhance resolution of spots on a TLC. So if you increase the length of the TLC plate, for example here, the distance traveled by spots will be more, and that's how resolution also can be improved, because they have to travel longer on TLC. The stationary phase on a TLC is mostly a silica gel. It's called silica gel G, and it has a 60 angstrom pore diameter. Average particle size of silica G is 15 micrometer. A thin layer around 0.3 millimeter thickness is overlaid on a solid surface like a glass surface or a aluminium or plastic surface to make a TLC plate. And even there is a variant of silica gel G which is called silica gel 254. So this contains a fluorescent compound. So when you use silica gel G254, you don't need to develop the spots, because you have fluorescent compound, so it can be visualized using a UV lamp. Then cellulose also can be used as a stationary phase in TLC. That's also polar in nature. And alumina is more commonly used than cellulose on TLC. In fact, silica gel and alumina, these are two very commonly used stationary phases in order to prepare TLC plates. And a stationary phase is chosen based on their chemical stability, loading capacity, and chemical nature. So in case of silica gel, it has higher loading capacity in comparison to alumina, whereas alumina can work as acidic, neutral, or basic. The three variants are possible, three type of interactions are possible in case of alumina, whereas in case of silica gel, the only polar interactions with the analytes are possible. Then mobile phase, the function of mobile phase is to carry analytes across a stationary phase. So the ability of mobile phase to move up, it depends on the polarity itself. Lesser the polarity of mobile phase, faster it moves. And mostly organic volatile organic solvents are used as mobile phase, like hexane, butanol, chloroform, methanol, ethanol, acetonitrile, and so on. So the another function of mobile phase is to solubilize analytes. So analytes should be well, also should be well soluble in the mobile phase in order it to be used. TLC can be used in order to identify unknown compounds, where known compound standard can be run together on the same plate with your unknown sample, and that's how identification of a known compound can be made. And to determine purity of the sample, if there is any impurity in the sample, so that also can be found out using TLC, whether there are more than one type of analytes present in the sample, that can be seen. And this is a very simple, rapid and cheap method, and widely used in pharmaceutical and food industry, and also in forensic analysis. The material required for TLC, you need a TLC plate, an alumina plate or silica gel plate, and you also need developing container, a container where mobile phase can be put and it's allowed to migrate across a stationary phase, a chamber, a jar or a glass beaker, and a pencil to mark ends of the TLC plate, a ruler in order to measure RF values, the distance migrated, distance traveled by different spots, a capillary pipe is used to load sample, and solvent mobile phase, a solvent is required, a mobile phase is required to run a TLC. It could be organic solvent. And of course, you need one analyzer or UV lamp, depending on what kind of a matrix stationary phase you are using. Detection of the spots. The color sample, they are easily seen. If analytes are colorful, they are colored, they can be seen on TLC by naked eye. So detection is very easy. Otherwise, a UV lamp also can be used in order to see them. If you are using fluorescent gel, in that case UV lamp is required. And there are more ways to detect compounds on TLC. The one is iodine staining. The TLC plate, after drying, it can be capped with crystals of iodine, and iodine vapors, they give non-specific color to the analytes. So dark spots are seen where analytes have migrated on the TLC plate. Then ninhydrin can be used if you are using nitrogenous compound in analyte in your sample, like amino acids. Ninhydrin can be sprayed on TLC plate. So ninhydrin will react with amino acid or nitrogenous compound to give a dark blue color. Then KMnO4 is also used. If you are using in analytes, you have reducing agents like glucose, fructose, etc. In that case, KMnO4 also can be sprayed on the TLC plate in order to visualize the spots. And alkaline tetrazolium blue, a dye which is specifically used for detection of corticosteroid. So corticosteroid can be identified using alkaline tetrazolium blue dye. And fluorescence also can be used if you are using silica gel G254. In that case, visualization of a spot under a UV254 lamp is made, and the adsorbent layer, the silica gel layer, will fluoresce in green light. So it is seen green, but wherever there is spot, there is a quenching of fluorescence. So dark spots are seen because fluorescence is missing where spots are there, where analytes have run. And once they are visible, their distances, RF values can be calculated from origin. Even in TLC, quantitation of analytes also can be made, where after visualizing spots, those spots can be scratched using a spatula, and a compound can be extracted in a suitable solvent from TLC plate. That compound solution can be analyzed or can be quantified using appropriate spectroscopic technique. Troubleshooting in TLC, many times solvent front runs unevenly. That is many times seen in case of while doing TLC experiment, and that is because of thickness of silica gel, thickness of slurry is uneven, or silica gel has fallen off from the slide. So that is also reason for solvent front running unevenly on a TLC plate. And if no spot is seen on the plate, that simply means the analyte concentration is too low, or the solvent level is too high when you keep TLC plate in solvent. So if solvent level is too high, solvent dissolves spots. So the sample is dissolved by the solvent, so there is no sample remain which run in TLC plate. Or that also can happen if sensitivity of the development method is low. If it means the analyte concentration is too low to be detected by that particular development method. So in that case, more concentration of compound can be loaded on TLC. And sometimes smeared blue spot is seen after TLC, and that's because if you use pen at place of a pencil while marking TLC plate, that ink also run and that give a blue color spot. So that's why always pencil is used to mark TLC plate. And if you see several unexpected spots, that means some adulteration, some mixing of some other compound has occurred with your sample. And many times, in fact, compound run as a streak rather than a spot. Instead of looking at a spot, you see a streak, a longer spot. So that is because of overloading. If high concentration of compound has been loaded, the resolution is compromised. There is a poor resolution. And or that also could be because of polarity of the mobile phase is not appropriate to resolve analytes well. So paper chromatography has similar principle as TLC. The only difference is that because paper is not as hard as a silica gel plate, so it is hanged from top into a jar which contain a mobile phase. And in similar way, like in TLC, mobile phase runs up and you load sample on the bottom, and the mobile phase takes sample along to the paper and separation occurs. Because paper is also polar in nature, cellulose makes paper. So like TLC, on the basis of polarity, samples are separated on paper chromatography. Now, leaf pigments separation using paper chromatography. In leaf, there are four major pigments. They are called keratin, chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, and xanthophyll. So these four pigments are easily separated from a leaf extract. Leaf extract can be made in ether in any volatile organic solvent, and it can be loaded on bottom of a paper, and ether can be used as a mobile phase. So ether takes these four compounds up to the across stationary phase, which is paper here. And we see that there are four bands: keratin, xanthophyll, chlorophyll A, and chlorophyll B. The migration of keratin is highest, whereas chlorophyll B has the lowest migration. And that also based on their polarity, because chlorophyll B, it has more polar groups. So it's more polar in all the four compounds, followed by chlorophyll A. And that's why the migration of chlorophyll B on paper is less, because due to polar interaction with the paper, it is hold back. It doesn't move well with the mobile phase. And similarly, xanthophyll is then followed by chlorophyll A, and beta keratin is least polar, so it migrate faster. So beta keratin migrate faster because it has opposite nature to the paper. So mobile phase easily carry it forwards, and that's why you get the top band as most less polar compound in form of keratin.